Welcome back to the Healthy with Heartland podcast. Thank you everyone for tuning in. Looks a little bit different today. We are missing our usual host, Justin Freistadt. He is away in the middle of the Pacific Ocean, enjoying time with his lovely wife in Hawaii. So yes, we congratulate him on that. And we hope to see you back soon.
Absolutely.
So we'll get right into the podcast today. If you're not already, be sure to be following us on YouTube. Check us out on our Instagram channel and also on our Facebook page. And with that, let's talk about a few announcements.
Let's do it.
So if you are a Heartland customer, you can take advantage of our reorder special. So you can restock from home without the hassle. We are going to be doing a November reorder special of a whole turkey, absolutely free with your reorder. So make sure to book that between now and the end of November. So if you place your order before November 30th, you'll get a whole turkey along with your order absolutely free. Just a quick shout out. I want to shout out all of our amazing Heartland families who referred in the month of October. Thank you so much for sharing the health. We really appreciate it. If you have not scheduled your pop-up yet, you can do so as well. We have amazing, super fun pop-ups put on by our event team. Lots of really cool things to get involved with. Join in with your friends, neighbors, and family. Invite them over. Have them taste some of our wonderful Heartland products. It's just a great way to introduce your community, friends, and family to Heartland Foods. So you can check that out at heartlandfoods.com/host-pop-up. And then we'll talk about a little bit about the Foodie Group before we get into today's episode. Mm-hmm. We want to talk about, you know, what's for dinner. Make sure you are going on the Heartland Foodies Group. Make sure you are joined and are a member of that first off. And then we'd love for you to post what it is that you guys are cooking up, sharing your recipes, your kitchen techniques, tricks, and things like that. And as well, if you are a member, you've probably already seen our 5K giveaway. So we're at 2,500 members, which is super awesome. Congratulations to the group. Once we reach 5,000 members, though, we are going to do an awesome giveaway. We're going to give away $2,000 worth of Heartland Farm Source products. So that is going to be very, very exciting.
It's huge.
All delivered to your home. So be sure to join and also invite your friends with that. And so with that, I guess, Simon, we can get into today's podcast.
Let's dive right into it. Absolutely. And before we actually get into it, if you are watching, make sure you go ahead and you comment, like this, share it with a couple people. The Foodies Group all around, I want to say, is like one of the best things. It's a great tool you can share with people where people are like, hey, what is Heartland all about? What do they do? It's just a place that you can go and receive more content about who we are and what we do, really. So
definitely, yeah.
Share it, like it. Let us know where you're watching from.
For sure. All right. So we're going to talk a little bit more about the Foodie Group today. If you follow us on any of our social media channels, you've seen that we do post and feature a lot of our Heartland foodie families. So we love seeing, you know, what you guys are cooking for dinner and posting those recipes so we can get some awesome ideas for what to cook with all the food that we have in our freezer. Yep. So I want to start off with one of the more recent posts in the group. So I'm going to pull that up.
Oh, yeah. And remember, don't go here hungry. Because the Foodies Group, if you are hungry and you start looking at it, it's like you need some sort of little treat next to you, maybe dinner.
Start salivating.
Kind of right away.
Awesome. Okay, well, the first one I wanted to bring up was a post by actually Nicole and Aaron Martin, I believe. So they did, I think it was, some chicken, some vegetables. I guess they basically said that Heartland has been stepping up their dinner and their dessert game.
Yeah.
So they do have like a peanut butter, it looks like delicacy down there, but they got some sort of chicken pot pie going on here in the corner. And then just the simple chicken and veggies here on the left. And so they said, for once, chicken tastes like chicken again. And I thought that was pretty cool.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, if you don't know, Murray's Family Farm chicken is by far, probably some of the best chicken I've ever had in my entire life. And no secret required here. Just a little salt and pepper goes a long way. But when you look at this dish, I mean, it's got all the colors of the vegetables. It's got the chicken breast there. And I mean, you know, like, did it say what the little drizzle was?
It didn't say the drizzle, but I have to correct myself because I jumped too far ahead. And this is actually Courtney Wamseldorf. Okay.
Wamseldorf.
So she posted this. She said, it's stir-fry vegetables with chicken. And then we got that sort of pot pie there. And then, of course, they featured the special dessert. So, Yeah, I'm not sure what the drizzle is. Looks maybe like some sort of mustard, maybe some honey mustard. Not really sure, but it does. It could be some sort of like an Asian mustard.
Oh, yeah.
I'm not really sure, but it looks like it could go with any of them.
Yeah, yeah. No, that's, I mean, that's looks so delicious. And it's probably healthy for you, too. You know what I mean? You got your veggies. You got your proteins. Doesn't get any better than that.
A little bit of everything.
Oh, yeah. Great. All right.
So this next one that we're going to feature is actually Leslie Lewis Dorsey. And she had a bunch of posts on there. It was actually hard for me to pick one because there were so many. But she said this is a beef cheesesteak Philly style. So you already know that's going to be delicious off the break. Then they got some diced red potatoes, some sliced white and red onions, and rosemary. And she did some asparagus as well here, and I guess topped both of the potatoes and the meat as well as the asparagus with the rosemary. And then she also did a plant-based Parmesan, so to each their own.
Yeah, absolutely. Okay. And I think also, I mean, you see the cast iron pan. I love cooking in a cast iron pan.
Oh, yeah.
That stuff's awesome.
Yes.
Especially for something like this. And it looks like the Philly cheesesteak without the actual bread, right?
Yep. It looks like it's kind of just like a scramble, as it were. And that looks like it could almost be like a brunch item.
Right.
You could do it for dinner or for brunch.
Yeah.
That's a great idea, Leslie. Thank you. Okay, the next one got me excited because recently I learned what, and I'm probably going to say it wrong, birria tacos means. Okay,
yeah.
So and just for anyone who is not familiar with it, this is a post by Veronica Gilmore.
When you have the two R's, you got
birria.
Yeah.
Is that correct?
Nice.
Okay. All right, perfect. So it basically is a stew where you cook, typically it's beef.
Yep, straight beef.
And you kind of get a really juicy meat because you almost kind of get some of the juices in there with it. And what's really interesting is they actually take the tortilla and they kind of dip it in the top layer of the stew, which is kind of where like the fats kind of rise to.
The leftover juices. Mm-hmm.
And so that goes on the whatever flat top, you know, they're cooking with it first and our pan you're cooking with.
Yeah.
And it kind of gets that little caramelization and then the stewed meat goes inside and it's just a wonderful
Amazing.
Eating experience.
Oh, yeah.
So when I saw these, I was like, wow, number one, they look traditional.
Mm-hmm.
And number two, looks phenomenal.
And I love the, you know, the addition of the cilantro there. I mean, that's like, you know what I mean? That's traditional as it gets right there. Just a little cilantro,
Definitely.
Maybe a little onions. But yeah, I mean, especially right now in the fall where these kind of things I feel like are that, you know, stick to your body, kind of healthy food, that little dipping of the extra
comfort
sauce,
food.
Almost like, yeah, that confit kind of style.
Oh, yeah.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah. And I mean, of course dipping they're served hot, juices. You know?
Oh, yeah.
And then what I think was great is like, typically, you know, you see this kind of thing out and I would have never thought to even attempt it at home, but clearly, you know, it looks wonderful. And I think it's something I'm going to try now.
It looks better than something you could have out, but I mean,
it does.
Oh
yeah. That's awesome. Veronica, thank you for posting.
Yeah. That's wonderful.
Okay, the next one I'm gonna bring up. So this one is Nicole Martin. So this is a skinny taste recipe, and I think a couple times we were talking to Ellie, Chef Ellie, and she was talking about she uses some of their recipes as well. So I don't know if you guys are familiar with that, but it seems like they have some really awesome recipes that you could probably check out online. Yeah. There's a spicy peanut chicken with vegetables and brown rice. And she said the reason why it's so easy is because it's actually a recipe from the sheet pan section. So this is kind of the throw it all on the pan, put it in the oven, almost like set it and forget it.
Yeah.
You take it out, and I think they kind of topped it with a little sriracha and this spicy peanut sauce, and bam.
I mean, we talk about it all the time, the convenience, right?
Yep.
Make it as easy as possible. That was something that Colin Jurgensen said on this the last podcast we had. I mean, that was pretty awesome. If you guys haven't seen that, make sure you go and check that one out.
Yeah.
It was literally last Thursday. And one thing he stated was, you know, make sure it's as easy as possible for you to do the things that are necessary. And this dish, it seems like that, right? Like it seems like, hey, you know, something that you can, you know, get to easily, but it's still nutritious for you. It's still delicious. And it, you know, basically hits all the boxes.
Yep.
As far as what you want in a meal.
Yeah. I would recommend if you guys haven't tried out that sheet pan technique, definitely test it out. And like Simon mentioned, if you've missed any of our previous podcasts, you can check them out on our YouTube channel. We post all the full episode recaps as well as on our Apple Podcasts, Spotify, and Google Podcasts. You can check us out on there weekly too. And you can download whichever podcast you want to listen to on the go.
Yep.
And so let's hop back in here to the next one.
Oh yes.
All right, so the next one is Rachel Aluzzi.
Okay.
So this is a steak and barley stew, and I thought this was super appropriate for fall time. We're kind of transitioning into winter. It's definitely getting a little bit colder, right? It's dark. We did a daylight savings, so the time is it's a lot darker earlier in the evenings now, which I hate, but it's okay. When you have food, you have food like this for dinner, I guess you know
that's
it kind of makes
I'm talking
up
about.
For it.
Exactly.
So yeah, this one was by the Aluzi family. Looks like she used some of the Muir Glen organic diced tomatoes that we offer in our pantry selections. Mm-hmm. Again, she cooked here in a nice ceramic pot. Like you mentioned, nothing better than a cast iron or ceramic pot. Mm-hmm. Something that, you know, is going to be healthy for you as well as making it easy and nonstick, right? Yep. And then she did some veggies in here. And then, of course, Creekstone Farms beef. So that just looks wonderful. And I'm sure it was melt in the mouth.
Using that Creekstone is definitely going to elevate your cooking to the next level.
Definitely.
You're chefing at home with the Creekstone beef. I mean, something like this, especially like you said, right now in the fall, mm-hmm. some stew, some sort of chili, something like that. Oh,
oh yeah.
And the presentation, it's...
Yeah, I know. I'm super impressed with not only the dishes and the creativity, but also the presentation and how, you know, all of these are being presented. And this next one I saw when I was just scrolling through, and I'm probably going to mispronounce this one too, but this is another one we were talking about recently. Mm-hmm. This was Nicole Santos, and she did a spicy pork japchae. So it's like a Korean kind of pork dish. Mm-hmm. Typically they use like a gochujang or some sort of like spicy sauce on it.
Oh yeah.
But she said she used the Cheshire pork tenderloin. She hand sliced it in there, and my mouth was watering when I was reading this.
Yeah.
She used a spicy Korean barbecue marinade for the meat, mm-hmm. and then she did bell peppers and onions, and then of course the japchae noodles, which are like the clear kind of I forget what they're actually made out of. I think they could be made of from a couple different things, but there's lots of different options. You know, there's like buckwheat noodles, there's
rice noodles.
Yeah. All different kinds, but these are kind of like the clear glass noodles.
Yeah.
So they definitely have like a specific texture to them, but I just thought, you know, the fresh peppers and onions, and then with the tenderloin and the noodles,
mm-hmm.
another one that, you know, I would never think to attempt to create at home. And wow, bravo.
Why not?
It looks wonderful.
I think it just, again, that Cheshire pork is going to elevate whatever dish you're making.
Yeah.
You know? So, I mean, you could use, you know, different ingredients and all that kind of stuff. I think this is just, I mean, this is a great way that you won't get bored. You know what I mean? With the food that you do have, you're able to, you know, cook any sort of recipe, use any ingredients, and then you know already that the meat that you're eating, it really only needs salt and pepper, but if you add anything else to it, it just elevates the eating experience.
Yeah. Tenfold. I feel like, you know, and again, my hat's off to everyone who's using all these recipes. You know, it's super simple when you find, you know, recipes that you like, and then, you know, flavors that you like. Right. And then, of course, you know, as simple as using peppers, onions, garlic in your dishes, they can really enhance the flavors of, you know, the things that you're cooking.
Yeah.
And then just, the ability to be creative and go into your freezer and choose, you know, hey, what do I want to use? Because you could have done beef in this dish, or you could have used chicken or pork. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, just to have that ability to be creative in that sense, I think it's really awesome. And what I've learned from just looking through the Foodie Group, and especially these recipes, is I need to step up my sauce and seasoning game, because I've seen a bunch of marinades, seasonings, sauces, and I think it's really cool.
Yeah, it's inspirational. And I think it takes away from the monotonous, you know, daily sort of routine to dinner. You know what I mean? Like you want to have something that's going to, you know, sometimes take you out of your comfort zone and actually, you know, try something new. And maybe it's not try something new, but maybe it's try cooking something new that you've had out. And with our products, I mean, you can create that same sort of flavor profile, that same sort of eating experience right at home.
Definitely.
And you know exactly what's going into it. I think that's the biggest one. I always drop the bomb for that, because you know exactly what's going into your food when you cook it at home.
Definitely. Yeah. I mean, here's another one. This is Natasha Colbank, actually. She said this was a breaded garlic chicken breast. Looks wonderful. Perfectly cooked, by the way. Mm. A homemade honey mustard sauce. And then it looks like some white rice and Heartland carrots. And then a little bit of parsley. And it's simple, yet it's perfectly executed. And I'm sure it tastes absolutely fantastic. But that's another... It looked like a winter meal to me.
Yeah.
It looked wonderful.
And I love, the presentation of it. You even have the you know, fall sort of background on the table, the tablecloth, the colors. Yeah. I mean.
Exactly.
I love it.
Okay. And then let's see.
I like the crust too. You have a nice sort of GBD, golden brown delicious crust
there. Yeah, that's
what
I'm saying. The breading and whatever method. I wonder what method this was, you know, cooked in. Maybe, like you mentioned, cast iron pan. Could have been air fry. Yeah, could have been broiled.
If you are air frying, you know, mention in the comments how you enjoy air frying and what types of methods you're using to sort of, you know, bread and do that kind of thing to your food. Yeah. Let us know in the comments.
Definitely. We talk about air frying a lot. And I know Justin's a huge proponent of it because he said it's super convenient. And again, we're always talking about pairing good tasting food and quality with convenience and having that be the, you know, the best of both worlds. So. Mm-hmm.
Hey, your mom's watching. She said, you're making me hungry. Great dishes.
Awesome. Yeah. Well, I mean, you can cook up these at any time. Yeah.
Thanks for watching.
Thanks for watching. All right. So let's see. Okay. So this next one, I had to, of course, mention Ellie. So Chef Ellie, she made a garlic studded steak or roast, beef roast from Creekstone Farms.
Oh, yeah.
And it looked absolutely wonderful. I guess she just kind of cut some holes and poked a little garlic in there. And I was like, wow, I'm sure that turned out fantastic. And I do have a photo of what it looked like afterwards. And I'm,
oh my goodness,
if you could give me maybe like a drum roll, because it just is literally wonderful. And this is the final product. Perfectly cooked. Again, I would love to know how she cooked this. Was this, it looks oven roasted from the pan that she's using, but it could be anything.
Yeah.
And it just, it looks fantastic. It's perfectly cooked. She definitely let it rest because you can see it's still juicy once she kind of sliced into it. But yeah, that's Creekstone Farms for you. The best quality, you know, 100% genetically tested black Angus beef paired simply with some vegetables. Looks like she made a little, I think like a mash, like a potato mash.
Oh, yeah.
And then you got the broccoli and the mixed veggies and some steak. And it doesn't get much better than that.
And as far as the seasonings, that looks like, what is that, thyme?
Yeah. Parsley, thyme, rosemary. Those are pretty traditional, but yeah, it does look like thyme.
Yeah. Ah, Ellie, she always has, I mean, phenomenal food.
Yeah, so she said basically it was about 4 or 5 cloves of garlic, slice them down into slivers, basically slice into the meat to insert the garlic into the little holes. She rubbed both sides down with olive oil, or you could use, you know, avocado oil, whatever kind of oil you're using. Generously season all sides with rosemary leaves, so with some rosemary, salt, and cracked pepper. And then what she did was she let it sit at room temperature for 1 hour. So she kind of let it rest even before she cooked it, which is a lot of times, that is something that I've heard before. You kind of take something right out of the refrigerator and, you know, with our products, you can basically thaw it out right there and get it cooking. But it is sometimes recommended to let it kind of get to room temperature before you begin cooking it. That way it sort of locks in all that moisture and all the juiciness that you want to keep inside just a little bit better.
Right.
So she oven roasted it at 350 in a roasting pan on a rack. So it wasn't touching. So it was able to get that nice convection air all the way underneath of it. That's why you see the caramelization on there. She tested it with a temperature probe and then removed it from the oven when it was between 130 and 135, which is rare for those listening. Then she let it sit for about 20 minutes before cutting, which is a properly letting it rest, of course. And then basically she said you could tent it with foil if you wanted while it was resting. And then afterwards slice it super thin and enjoy.
Yeah. I know you mentioned like, hey, she took it out when it was rare, but I think it's important to also note that, you know, the reason she's taking it out at that time is because it is going to cook a little bit more as it is resting.
Correct.
So, you know, if you're like, hey, I do my meat medium, I don't want to take it out when it's rare because it may be undercooked, you know, it's going to cook even more as it is resting.
Yeah.
So that's why it's pretty important, you know, feature there, not only to lock in all the juices, but then also so that you know, hey, yeah, it is going to cook a little bit more as it is resting. It is going to trap all that juice and flavor into the actual meat.
Definitely. And I mean, if you wanted it, you know, a little bit more towards, and I'm not going to say well done, but if you wanted it towards the more, you know, medium well side, you could take it out more at like a 140, 145, which would be closer to medium rare. And, you know, you could kind of go from there.
If you wanted to.
That's just preference.
Right.
Just preference. All right. So this one is another one. This is just a quick honorable mention, which I wanted to bring up. It was a bacon wrapped filet mignons.
Oh, yeah.
Cooked by Frank Shannon Jr. So I thought that was wonderful and it definitely deserved a quick honorable mention.
Absolutely. I mean, bacon with anything. You can put bacon in much any dish.
Bacon's almost like its own food group.
It is. You know, some people are like, yeah, you know, I don't eat pork. And then we go and we're like, oh yeah, we have this kind of bacon. Oh yeah, we have bacon. We eat bacon.
I mean,
it's its own kind of.
It is. It's its own food group.
It's its own food group. It's gotta be.
And you know, we have a lot of bacon fans here in the Heartland family too. We always talk about, you know, what's your favorite? Do you prefer the Cheshire? Do you prefer the smoked? Do you prefer the thick cut?
Right.
You know, the lighties. So we can have a whole
episode on that.
We have some bacon fans out there. That's for sure.
Yeah. What is your favorite?
Oh, that's so hard because I do like a thick cut bacon, mm-hmm. but the Leidy's is so good. It has wonderful like smoked taste, mm-hmm. and it's not too thin where it's almost like over crispy. Mm-hmm. I do like my bacon super crispy. So, yeah. Oh, that's so hard. I'm almost like I'm 50-50 with that one.
Now I have another question, Shannon. So when mm-hmm. you are doing that bacon wrapping, are you familiar with like how to make sure that the bacon is kind of crispy when you're wrapping it around like, you know, like scallops or something like that? In terms of the cooking technique?
Well, I mean, like, I'm not 100% sure.
Yeah.
I know that, like, if you, like, Ellie did, cook things on, like, a rack. Like, a lot of people will have some sort of, like, rack that goes in a pan where they cook the bacon because it lets the grease drip down. And then also, like I mentioned, lets, like, the air kind of get underneath of it. So you get just as good of a cook and you don't get soggy on the bottom and crispy on the top, which you know, what you don't want. I'm sure if you have an air fryer, it's not an issue. You could probably get it cooked, you know, super crispy. But you also don't want it too crispy before you wrap. So I'm sure there's a certain time between when it's I would assume that you need to partially cook it. Or if it's like something smaller and you're using a really thin piece of bacon, you're going to be cooking something for a long enough time that it's going to cook in the oven. That's probably fine.
Yeah.
Or like prosciutto, that gets wrapped a lot too. And that's very thin. It's already cooked ahead of time, so you don't have to worry about it.
Yeah.
So to answer your question, I'm not sure.
Yeah.
But I definitely know that you can help, like in a cast iron pan, you can help like kiss the sides of the pan, as Chef Arden used to say, and that will help kind of cook the bacon itself. But, you know, letting it rest, all those things kind of help. And I'm sure it's trial and error as well.
I would imagine, like you said, it's probably some form of like, you know, cooking it to a certain state and then finishing it after you kind of wrap it.
Right.
You know?
Yeah.
Because, you know, you do want it crispy, but at the same time, if it is just, you know, like, I don't think if it's too crispy, you're not going to be able to kind of wrap it around, right?
No,
it'll just be
not.
Like a board.
It would crack. It would break.
It would crack, right.
Yeah.
So it has to have some sort of, you know, probably medium.
Some give to it.
Exactly.
And then the other thing too, is I thought you were going to ask like, how do you secure it? And like, that's another great question as well, because I'm sure there's lots of different ways. I know like a toothpick is one way that's, you know, commonly used. You could use a toothpick, take it out once it's cooked, and then most of the time it's kind of like stuck together once it's already been cooked.
Yeah.
But I'm not sure. I'm sure there's other techniques and tricks. Actually, if you're familiar with any of them, post them in the comment section below, because we would love to know, and I'm sure everyone else who's watching would love to know as well.
Yeah.
But yeah, I have a couple more that we could get through. Let's see. This one was from Manny Weber. Thought this was awesome. It was a slow roasted brisket. And he did it in a kind of unconventional way, but I really liked it. He added the recipe actually on there as well. It's slow roasted brisket, Heartland brisket, a can of cranberry sauce with the whole berries, one pack of Lipton onion soup mix, and 6 medium onions cut into rings. Mm-hmm. He said basically 1 to 1 cup of beef broth. So you can just use that to kind of keep it moist as it's cooking.
Right.
You place the brisket fat side up on the bed of onion rings and you slather it with the cranberry sauce. You sprinkle the soup mix on top of that. And
you want the fat side up because it's going to sort of, like you said, you want the juices.
It's going to baste itself. It's going to self baste. And because, you know, our products are hand trimmed, you know, they're not going to be super, super fatty. So I think that's why he mentioned adding in like the broth so you can keep that moisture, but you can guarantee that it's going to have an amazing crust and like a delicious tender flavor. It's going to melt in the mouth once it's cooked.
Oh yeah.
So he did this low and slow. So 275 for 7 to 8 hours, basting it with that kind of liquid that's in that, you know, pan. Every half hour, and then tenting the foil over top of it for the first couple hours. And then once it's done, slicing against the grain. And he said when you eat it with the onion, it has so much flavor.
Oh yeah, I can see you're salivating right now.
I'm
just
like,
talking about it.
Because it just was really creative, and I thought it was just different. And I'm sure, like, you know, that kind of cranberry flavor, it's almost like a kind of gravy. And it's got me ready for Thanksgiving. I'm thinking about it. But I thought that was pretty cool.
Yeah. And I like onions, so I can see, you know, I mean, pairing that with the onions and having that sort of, did he say what type of onions it was? Because it looks like just the...
He didn't, but I think they're just white traditional white onions. Yeah.
Adds a little bit of sweetness to it. Probably a little bit of acidity.
Yeah, definitely. Let's see. And then I do have...
Oh, sorry. One more time. What was the top? The crust?
It was a Lipton onion soup mix. So it's like a French onion kind of soup mix. Mm-hmm. Yeah, just to add the seasoning on there.
It's genius.
All right. And what's the, we got another one for you.
Let's see. I am going to just do a couple honorable mentions because these were just such wonderful food photos that I wanted to include them. Mm-hmm. This one was Dennis and Victoria Madden. She said, boom, I don't know what you call it, but there it is, and it's delicious. And I wanted to highlight this because it was super simple. It was just chicken breast, green beans, and rice, but oh so delicious, good for you, and takes less than 20 minutes to get on the table from frozen from your freezer. So there is nothing better than that.
That's a classic. I mean, that's a classic dish right there.
It is.
And the chicken, the green beans.
The chicken are some of my favorite because, again, you can use rice. That sheet pan method. You can cook a bunch of them all at one time, and boom, that's how we do our meal prep. And I love that you can get the 4 ounce and the 6 ounce.
Depending
on the cutlets or the breast, depending on what you'd like and portion size, and it's super convenient for us. This other one is Sharon Lacey. This was beef stew on a cold, rainy night. Oh. Looked delicious. Got some vegetables in there. I could see potatoes, carrots, peas. You got some mushrooms, onions, celery. Looks awesome. And then she's cooking it in a slow cooker.
Yep.
So again, convenience is key. Make it easy for yourself. Make it simple. This is something you can throw together in the morning.
Yep.
You could actually do it halfway through the day.
Yeah.
Just depending on, you know, what kind of things you want to add in there. You can just check the pantry, find things lying around, just, you know, throw them in there.
And I like the addition of mushrooms because that's one thing we're trying to incorporate more into our diet is more mushrooms and that kind of thing. And I like the addition to that because it gives it, you know, like if you were whatever amount of beef you were using, it's going to give it even that more meaty kind of flavor.
Yeah.
That also that texture on, you know what I mean? I like eating mushrooms as well. Cause sometimes it's, you know, it fills you up.
Yeah.
You feel like you're eating a piece of steak when you're eating a mushroom. And then when you combine it with that, like a steak Diane,
yeah.
When you combine those mushrooms,
we'll make like a sauce with it too.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. And they have different flavor profiles. Like you mentioned, there's like, you know, shiitake, you got portobello mushrooms that you got like the white little button mushrooms. There's so many different ones and they all have different flavors and textures. So, you know, those are great things to incorporate.
What's the one that's like an ear?
An ear? I don't know. I mean, there's so many. There's lion's mane. There's reishi. There's oyster mushroom. There's trumpet mushroom.
I think it's the trumpet one.
Yeah, there's so many. Yeah, and they're really, really great. And some of them, I mean, like you can throw them in the air fryer. You can just put them in a roasting pan, a sheet pan. Throw them in the oven. They're great to incorporate with like if you ever do seasoned roasted potatoes, or if you do like butternut squash or things like that. They're really great to incorporate. Again, you can use onion, garlic, peppers, mushrooms to flavor and season your food.
That mirepoix.
Yeah. Let's see. We got another one. This is Jessica Robinson. She said, huge shout out to Justin and Elise for recommending the Bavette steak when we placed our reorder. It's so tender and delicious. Thank you. And this is what's so awesome about the wellness consultants that basically meet with you and, you know, go over your customized menu for your family, you know, make a specific plan that's designed for you. Mm-hmm. You know, they have all the education behind, you know, these different cuts and things that we don't even know are available in the stores. Like Bavette steak is not a common steak that you can find.
Had you heard of it before?
I hadn't. It's actually known as, I think, like the sirloin flap.
Mm-hmm.
But it is sirloin and it's delicious and it's not something that grocery stores typically carry. So this is something that is, you know, specific to us at Heartland Foods that we can provide for our families that allow them to have a delicious tasting steak. And the thing is, it's more cost effective than your, you know, your more traditional cuts of steak that it can be super expensive.
Yep.
So this is an awesome addition. Bavette steak with broccoli, simple, easy, and delicious.
And if you didn't know, Justin is the Bavette barista. That's why he's serving them up. He's letting everybody know about these Bavettes because he's the Bavette barista.
Yes. So. We got another one here. Here's a little foodie feature. This one's Zach. He's got a protein
custom
smorgasbord, Cobia taco, Murray's chicken breast, butterfly coulette steak. Coulette is another butcher's cut. So we had the Bavette. Now we're seeing the coulette steak.
Oh, yes.
So those are some good ones. And, of course, it always looks delicious.
Yeah. And, I mean, you can see there, Zach's got the seasonings. He's got, oh, I mean, he's the custom cut, man. So if you guys don't know and you're not sure about what cuts and what you'd like to try, Zach is a you know, phenomenal expert at the different cuts that we have and getting people the different roasts. And I think he even recommended one to someone the other day about like the, I can't even think about it. It's the barbecue that people are usually barbecuing.
Brisket.
Ah, I can't even think of it. But yeah, he's recommending the brisket and that kind of thing. So if you have any questions, definitely reach out to him. The custom cut man, Zach.
All right, let's see. This next one is another fall favorite. It's a carnival squash stuffed with Marco's Italian sausage and Heartland spinach. Mm. So this one's super easy. cut it open. Again, this is another one you're going to roast in the oven. She used Marco's Italian sausage. We, of course, have mild sausage. We got sweet sausage. We got hot sausage. We got turkey sausage. We got turkey Italian sage. So many different flavors that you can try this fall, you know, in your stuffings. Here she's stuffing, obviously, squash. You could do stuffed peppers. You could do stuffed jalapenos. There's so many different things you could do, but this looks amazing. Again, super simple. Throw a little bit of Parmesan cheese on top of it, side of green beans or broccoli, and you're good to go.
Now, when you're talking about things like, you know, you were saying before, things that are a little bit, you know, untraditional, maybe, you know, that's something. That's what the beauty of this foodie group is, because I would have never thought to stuff a squash.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I've heard of stuffed peppers before, but I would never thought of to stuff a squash. And it is, again, we keep going back. It's fall. Squash is one of those fall flavors.
It's
that's pretty
seasonal,
awesome.
It's a seasonal vegetable as right. well. And so, you know what I mean? Not only is it good for you, but, it, you know what I mean? This is kind of the time to be enjoying those things. And it's super simple that you can throw it in the oven. And then again, you're kind of just going to scoop it out along with the, you know, the insides of that squash. And it's going to be phenomenal.
Yeah. And what is the importance of eating, you know, those seasonal vegetables or... you know, the seasonality of produce.
Yeah. I mean, people talk about, you know, before industrial agriculture, the thing that we did was eat the fruits and vegetables that were in season, right? Mm-hmm. The stuff that grows in the summer is not the same stuff that grows in the winter. So it varies based on the season. And so does your, you know, your digestive system, your metabolism, you know, things with your circadian rhythm change as soon as like it gets darker earlier. Mm. All those things kind of play into health and wellness just in general. But yeah, I mean, it's recommended that you eat of the seasons and that you, you know, incorporate some of those things into your diet because that was, you know, traditionally what was had in the past.
Yep.
For sure. So let's see. The next one was Jennifer Kostick. I had to throw one of those in there. She did a smoked Heartland flank steak. Sounds amazing. Yes. Multicolor cauliflower and broccoli. It's great, again, to get in those different colors. Purple potatoes, purple carrots, green and purple broccoli. So good for you. She did steamed leeks and multicolored potatoes with baked apples. That sounds wonderful. Eat the rainbows, what she said. Yeah,
that's right.
That's wonderful. It's really wonderful. And then we got another one. I actually have two back-to-back from the Kinney family. This is John and Jen Kinney. Hey, guys. This is the Creekstone fillets sautéed with broccoli and potatoes fried with avocado oil. Looks amazing. This could have been another brunch item as well. And then to back that up, we have another one from John and Jen Kinney. This was homemade orange chicken with rice. So they did, and it looks like... it looks amazing. I want to know how you breaded and cooked that chicken because it looks wonderful and still crispy, which is hard to do with the sauce on it.
Right.
So boneless, skinless chicken breast, basmati roast.
Because you toss it before. You know what I mean? Like you're sitting there, you're probably doing a little, I don't know if you did it in the pan or maybe the air fryer, and then you toss it in the sauce.
Yeah.
Because if you toss it in the sauce beforehand, I can tell you from experience, it is going to get soggy and it's probably not going to be. It'll taste good. It just won't be as, like, it won't look as good aesthetically. Like this dish does.
Yeah. This looks amazing.
Yeah.
I want to try that.
And John, I mean, he has some of the best posts in the Heartland Foodie Group. Every time I see the same thing, the presentation, just the different flavors and stuff, I'm like, man.
Yeah. And shout out to him. He was actually one of our participants at our Heartland Welcome Celebration for the barbecue brawl. He had amazing pulled pork.
It my goodness.
Fantastic. Yes. Loved it. Let's see, we got another one here. This is Chrissy Neighbors. She said she wanted to join in on the party because we had so many posts coming in, I think, of people's amazing looking dinners. So she made some carne asada tacos at home, and they look phenomenal as well.
Yep. Just your steak tacos. I mean, again, eating the rainbow, you got your red, your green, the avocados in there, traditional with the onions and just the cilantro. And the tortillas look like they're nice. And I like it when they're kind of like that, too. They have that little bit of a Christmas. Yeah.
Yeah.
Enough that you can fold it and that it won't crack, but that, you know, it gives you like a nice little kind of crunch to it. Those look really good. Actually, I had tacos last night.
Very nice. Yeah. I mean, I just, we thought that it was important to come and kind of showcase a lot of these awesome meals that everyone's sharing. Yeah. We feel grateful to be a part of the foodie community. And like Justin always says, if there's one thing that you can do, it's invite your friends, family, neighbors, anyone who would like to learn about Heartland Foods or just wants to learn about, you know, cooking being healthy,
recipes,
making food at home, being together, enjoying a meal, because that's what it's all about at the end of the day.
Right.
That's what we love to provide for families, right, is cleaner, safer, healthier food, better options, conveniently delivered to your home so that you can spend more time doing the things that you love and being with the people that you love most.
And what better month to do that than in November, right? When you can celebrate that great time, being around family, being around friends. I mean, this past year 2020 was, you know, we were all separate. Now, yep. I mean, as we're, you know, maybe your circles are still kind of closer together, but still, I mean, it's great to get out there and be part of a community online. Definitely. And be able to kind of share the experiences as far as like the food and you know, just health and wellness. Yep. I think it's pretty awesome.
That's what it's all about.
But don't go there hungry, though.
Definitely don't go there hungry. Definitely join us next week. Every Thursday, we meet at 9:30 a.m. on Facebook Live. We also post all the episode recaps on YouTube, or you can check them out on Google Podcasts, Apple Podcasts, or Spotify if you happen to miss them.
Right.
We will be here again next Thursday spreading value. Justin will be back with us. Yes. And we look forward to meeting with you all then. So I guess with that, we appreciate everyone joining in, and we'll see you next week on the next episode. Stay healthy with Heartland.